Fabulous. Welcome to the show, Rookie. How are you doing?
I'm good, thanks.
Okay, I wouldn't want to do the intro myself. I would just like the fans to know you yourself. Now, who is Rookie? One know you. I think it will be your first time I'm getting you on the channel. I've been wanting to get you on the channel for a very long time. And I would like to leave the floor to you so you can introduce yourself. I think you should speak to the house yourself.
Yes, obviously, my name is Big Rook, aka Rookero. So I'm based in the UK and I'm a content creator. And I'm also an entrepreneur on the side. I put on many hats.
All right. Don't forget to actually be adding your the link. If you want that, I will be adding the link to your channel to this video when I'm uploading the link to the video. So welcome, Rookie, once again. It's really good to have you here. Don't forget to our viewers, if this happens to be the first time you're going to be on the channel, don't forget to like, don't forget to subscribe, please. And you can also, please always remember to share also. Thank you so much. And we'd like to go into business as quick as possible. And I think I would like to kind of get your opinion about the just concluded African Cup of Nations. You know, I want to know your perception of, you know, as we happen to be in Nigeria, I kind of have a full idea of how everybody took it in Nigeria. But before I kind of go into our homemade meltdowns and the rest of them, I want to know what's the perception of the diasporas, those Nigerians that are out there. What do you guys think about the African Cup of Nations? You know, our style of play, we came second in the competition. What's your general opinion about the African Cup of Nations and in Nigerian football in general?
So what I think about is that, like, when you look at how far it went compared to last time, it was an improvement because you saw in the first match, we brought in, like, the goalkeeper. Uzo was dropped completely, and as an general, I'm happy because that Uzo, before the tournament, he'd been costing us a lot of points, making us lose matches, whether it was qualifying matches or friendlies that we could have won. We dropped points because of his goalkeeping errors. And then when we dropped him for the tournament, we started to see, okay, that we were not making any goalkeeping errors. The team looked reasonably okay and a lot better. But when I look at the team overall, defensively, we look solid and better. Fullbacks are good. Central defense is reasonably okay. I kind of feel our midfield seems to be the main problem, where it's the attacking. I feel like it's the attacking midfield, because with the attacking midfield, it feels like we don't have any player who can thread that pass, like, you know, the eye of a needle. That one who can create a lot of opportunities and big moments. So, like, you know, like an Nigerian midfielder in the form who can be like a JJ Okocha or Adebayo, like all those legends who played in the 1994 and 1998 team. And I feel like with that being said, that was almost for majority of the tournament papering over the cracks. But a lot of people who were like non-Nigerians, they failed to see the bigger picture. They were trying to act as if, oh, Nigeria going into this tournament, we're favorites, we're this and that. And I was telling some people before the final that Nigeria team in transition, we're not the favorites for the game, for the final against Ivory Coast. I said Ivory Coast are the favorites. Our people, because a lot of people like to have all these agendas, they don't want their points to be proved wrong. And yes, okay, the coach Pesira changed the way we play to make us more solid, but in a way, it kind of made us less of a threat attacking wise. And
you mean pragmatic, right?
It was a bit too pragmatic. And I felt like when I see the final, we should have been more proactive rather than reactive. Because, like, when I look at the two times we were dominated in the AFCON South Africa game, and then in the first half, and then against Ivory Coast, dominated. That's the first time in history I've ever seen Nigeria be dominated by an African team. I've never seen it. I've never seen it before. It's unheard of.
Yeah. But one thing I need you to understand is this. Like you mentioned, you said, no team in the world has got the divine right to actually win a tournament. The only divine right I feel personally that any team should get, it should be to compete. And even though many of our, after we got to the finals, people were expecting us to be so-called champions, I was surprised and shocked at the meltdown we got here from the from our local fans. You know, I believe personally that one of the going into the tournament, I never expected us to get to the final of the tournament, but unfortunately or fortunately, we got to the final of the tournament, and now we felt like, oh, we now possess the divine right to win it. So the only time right now it's going to make sense, you know, the only thing that makes sense to people would be we're winning the tournament. Now, because we didn't win it, there was so much meltdown. Everybody was up in the air. Everybody was saying a lot of things to the extent of the social media abuse. I think it would be was people got on his case online to the extent that it would be was. We read the news that he was thinking of quitting the national team football. Now, like you mentioned, you said we were solid at the back. We made adjustments to the goalkeeper. We had a very good striker. But I've always thought of it since we called up all these players, I felt we were short in the midfield. We had likes of Wilfred Ndidi, who would have been a support to the midfield, but he was injured during the tournament. I still don't know the reason why Teller. I think you remember Teller at Leverkusen.
I know why. Because the first half of the season, he wasn't playing that regularly. So he was mainly playing like a lot of substitute appearances by Leverkusen. It's only this second half of the season that he's been playing more regularly. And even in the recent game he played in the big game that was against Bayern Munich, he played his part. He provided an assist in Leverkusen's 3-0 win over Bayern Munich, the giants of the Bundesliga.
That's what I'm saying. Now, finally, we also have some midfielders who could have helped us, who actually have not yet decided to play for us. Probably they are expecting call ups from another continent. For example, Eberechi Eze and Olise. I think you know that both of Crystal Palace. Yeah. I think they have the right. They still haven't chosen to play for Nigeria. But generally, you being in diaspora, you being out there, what is the general opinion of your friends who happens to be Nigerian who are out there looking at the team? Do they also have meltdowns like we here in Africa, whereby we are over the moon? We're like, oh, this is this. We shouldn't have gotten this. We should have won the game. I don't really know what our people wanted. A team that has played pragmatically from the beginning of the tournament suddenly gets to the final and becomes a free-flowing side. I think that is, if we were expecting that, that is actually not going to come to fruition. But what is your perception, you guys out there, like, generally, overall, the tournament, what do you think? How do you think the tournament fare for the Super Eagles? And what do you think should be the next step after this? How do we build on this?
Yeah, so I feel like a lot of people, mainly social media, are just having a bit of a slight meltdown. Like some people, like a lot of people want the coach gone. Most people were not really a fan of the coach to start with. But when I think about it, I feel going forward we need to try and sort out the coach situation, because also the World Cup qualifiers resumes in March and we can't afford to drop any more points, because we've already like had a poor start to the World Cup qualifiers, even though we're only a point behind the team that's second and a point behind first, but we need to start getting wins. So I feel the NFF need to make a decision quickly and fast. Do not waste time. Like, in Pesero, whose contract is already expired, let him go. Go bring in a Nigerian coach. Bring in either Emmanuel Monique or Finidi George. Let them take over because they already know the team. They know what needs to be done to the team to now, like, get over the finish line, and they will do, like, the job that is actually required. And
Well, you're saying something. I can hear you.
And with that being said, I also feel with the positions, like, that obviously I feel it's just a few tweaks. Like, I feel midfield is like it's probably bringing in Nathan Teller. He probably could be the answer to either attacking midfield or to be played on the wings, because he can play as a right wing as well. But I also, yep. and people fail to understand. We also have these guys who were to come back and play for us. Taiwo Awoniyi, who was in good form before his injury.
Nottingham Forest,
and he's just regaining his form again, continuing where he started off. And I think Boniface, he's not back till April, I believe. So I think we probably won't see him play for the Super Eagles till June. But I've also heard a story somewhere. I've heard somewhere that there's another player who plays for, I think, Bologna. He used to play for Bayern Munich. Mixed race Nigerian. He's half Nigerian, half Dutch. He wants to play for Nigeria. Joshua Orobosa.
Ziki. The guy with the bushy hair.
The mixed race Nigerian.
Yes.
But when I think about it, if he was to play for Nigeria, I don't think he's when I look at his position, he's a typical centre forward. I see him as like a second striker. Someone who can play across the front line. Who will give us versatility.
I think, and right now I noticed that we've actually got cover in the front line. And somehow, as in that front line alone, we have Victor Boniface, we have Taiwo Awoniyi, we have Victor Osimhen, we have Umar Sadiq, and so many others like that. We're kind of stuck at the front. I think the problem has been in midfield, and that's why I'm more concerned about the likes of Eberechi, and probably maybe the coach will look inward in the local league. Now, the problem I feel we have is this. Even personally, I in Nigeria, who loves to watch football, cannot actually watch our local league because I notice that our local league is not even being broadcasted. People can't even get to see those players that plays in the local league. They are not able to relate and also, you know, join with them. It's only a league that you watch that can improve. We don't have, right now, I'm even in Nigeria, I can't watch the Nigerian Premier League. There was a time an app was developed. I think they developed an app for us to actually watch the match. I think I subscribed onto the app. I think I was able to watch just one match for a month subscription. And the whole thing was not actually happy. The way I'm so crazy about EPL, which we'll get into very, very soon. I also want to watch the Premier League, the Nigerian Premier League, but I don't have access to it. Even our normal local stations could not give us that particular league. And I don't see the reason. I don't see how the league is going to develop and how we're going to get players. Now, we have gotten strikers. We are able to get defenders from out there. But the issue I'm having right now is that we don't seem to be able to produce midfielders who could complement our attack. Hopefully, we'll be able, maybe in the Nigerian League or anywhere in the world, just like we have. But I think NFF needs to look into our league and also make it a little bit better, generate more income, and the league becomes stronger. South Africa came in AFCON with averagely with the team of Mamelodi Sundowns. I think Sundowns, they have larger percentage of their player playing for Sundowns. So why can't our league be better? I think that is the challenge I feel, and I feel we need to improve on. And then, like you said, on the national team coach, we should just stop the idea of the Portuguese coach, foreign coach. Let's get our local coaches. The last coach that won this tournament for us is a Nigerian. So why are we actually going out there?
You know, that's my thought.
You are very, very right on that. Yes, I you want to say something here?
Yeah, you know, like the last time we won was like we had a Nigerian coach, and he was a former player of ours, the late great Stephen Keshi.
Stephen Keshi, yeah.
And
that's what I believe. I believe we can get better. Anyway, finally, on that note, basically, I just wanted to know, the diasporas, you guys out there, you believe the Super Eagles can actually improve on what we have? Do you believe we can improve on what we have done so far and probably expect ourselves to be competing higher and probably winning the African Cup of Nations in the next 2 years? Do you think that is the solution? Like, if NFF should go to a local coach, that we can actually make it on the final note?
Yes, I feel that's possible because when I look at that team, I don't feel like it's kind of like a lot of, I don't feel it's like major surgery that is needed to the team. I just feel it's just a few things and the team will become like relatively better. It might not take as long as people think, but we'll wait and see what the future holds.
All right, thank you very much. Thank you very much on that. And don't forget, viewers, I think we're about 16 minutes into the video. Don't forget to smash the like. Don't forget to subscribe. And once again, I would just like to give you a lowdown of my guest. This big rookie is joining me here from the UK. And now it's time to talk about the club that we love. I think we've said enough about the Super Eagles. Let's make ourselves happy a little bit and let's talk about Arsenal. He's a big Arsenal fan. It stays in the UK. I believe it goes to the game. I've told him, please make sure you, when you are at the game, I think I asked you this question the last time we spoke about Arsenal. How does it feel, you know, as a foreigner going to watch the game? How does it feel when you go to watch the game for a game day for you? Let's assume you're going to the game today. How do you feel going into the game, going to an Arsenal game for the day?
Yeah, actually, it feels good. Like the atmosphere is just different. It's just different when you're there. Because you're there with other Arsenal fans, yeah. You experience obviously days where sometimes things might not be going your way for your team, and you just got to stay positive and have that hope.
That's nice. I'm looking forward to one day or the other also being there, because I know, you know, it's always nice supporting the club you love. And you know, I feel the atmosphere in the stadium is always even electric. Even though we watching from abroad, I know how tense it gets, especially when you go out there to watch. And so I think I can imagine that. And quickly, I want to talk about Arsenal. Generally, this season on Arsenal, what has been your take so far? What has been your take over Arsenal? You know, we had that good start, then terrible good December, and terrible during December we were well at the top, and suddenly at the new year we were like points drifts the top. What is your general opinion? How do you think Arsenal have fared so far? And with the recent surgeons, the trip to Dubai, and we are back here, West Ham 6-0, a lot of the changes in the team. What has been your opinion about Arsenal so far this season?
I feel my take on Arsenal so far is that like we've just been keeping up with the teams above us. So the teams in the title race, Liverpool, Man City, and the one thing I'd say that I've seen from Arsenal is that they've been very resolute defensively, and Declan Rice, if we win the league, he'll be the difference. Because of obviously how much he's actually elevated our team, we don't concede a lot of chances. Like we're very good at controlling possession. But the one thing about us this season is that like whenever we go behind in matches, we've not been able to sort of come back. And the one thing that shocks me is that whenever we've gone behind in matches, we've struggled to score, or the team will just be pragmatic. But like with Arsenal, people will probably say, oh, we should have signed a striker in January or the summer. But I feel like when you think about it, Arteta might have wanted to get a striker in the summer. I feel the uncertainty with regards to Balogun's future sort of complicated things, because Arteta might have wanted to keep Balogun, but because he couldn't reassure him of game time, Balogun decided, you know what, he wants to leave. And that was fair enough. But at the same time, I feel like Arsenal sort of should have tried to keep him and sell Nketiah. Because a lot of people have said, oh, Balogun only scored a lot of goals because it's the French league. I get that, but there are a lot of good players in the French league, and I feel a lot of fans, they don't even watch the league properly. They just say a league is bad just because, oh, the pace is slower, but they don't really understand like too much about a league. Some people just watch comps of a player, but they've never watched a player in depth to see how good they are.
Well, now, sorry, there's a question I've been wanting to ask you. You know, we keep complaining that we expect our team to actually get a striker, get a striker, get a striker. We want the team to spend money. We want them to spend this money because we're one of the biggest club in the world, and we expect us to spend money. But would you prefer Arsenal sign a lot of players, probably get a striker, who knows, maybe get a Victor Osimhen, or get a Tony, and we win the league this year, and next year we fall under the rule, the FFP rule, or the self-sustainability rule, the one they broke? And let's assume we now find ourselves in the situation of Everton, or probably even right now, Man City being champion and who have won everything. There is a current stigma on them, you know, that they have actually done it, you know, they've actually that allegedly they actually cheated, that they have. Not they've actually broken the rules. Now, as an Arsenal fan, as somebody who actually wants your team to win trophy, do you actually want us to win this trophy with and with this kind of a stigma looming on it, or you prefer us just win the Premier League with the process which we are following, trying to, you know, go to the right place and be sustaining and the rest of them? Would you prefer we just go through this year and take a longer period for us to achieve it, or by any means, just get the players, and you don't care about the FFP or the FFP saga and this. As a fan, what do you think as an Arsenal? But I'm wanting to ask, what would be your take on that?
Yeah, I prefer us to actually do things the way we've been going through the process, rather than trying to win at the cost of FFP. Because if you win at the cost of FFP, and you now face like deduction of points or whatever, there's no point of risking at all for FFP. Because
Yeah,
then it's just gonna be costly, and you don't know if they're gonna remove you from Europe because of FFP.
it's just something that has always been, because I noticed many of Arsenal, because I do listen to a lot of people, you know, on social media. I listen to a lot of football podcasts, even from those people in the UK. You know, at first I thought, you know, I thought some people could be over. Some people really, the way they speak, they don't care. Like, just get this, they just win this league, just get the league done at all costs, just make sure we just want to win the league. Is it about just winning the league, or winning the league the right way, as in the right way? Because basically, one of the pride we have, even personally as an Arsenal fan, one of the pride I have and I enjoy watching Arsenal for is the fact that we actually do things the right way, even though it has been painful, you know, watching some of our best players leave just because of profit and sustainability. But I still appreciate that, and I want to support the club the more because I feel we are doing it the right way. Now, immediately, I feel personally like immediately we lose this dignity, and we kind of now get, although we win the trophy, but there's now a shade to it. I feel personally I might not like it, and that's the reason why I prefer the way we're going. I just hope that we get it quickly and get the job done. And I've been wanting to know the opinion of some other Arsenal fans about it. Now, speaking of, I don't want us to dwell on the West Ham game. Looking at Burnley, we're playing Burnley on the weekend. Saturday, I think it says 4 p.m. kickoff Nigerian time. That will be 3 p.m. UK time, I guess. So what's your take? How do you think the team will fare? Do you think, and your prediction for the game, what do you think about the game?
I think with regards to the game, I think it should be an easy win for us, because Burnley, everyone is just beating them. Because they're playing, obviously, they're trying to play attacking football, which Vincent Kompany's trying to get them to play beautiful football. But the issue with them is that they just don't have the players. And that's why, because they'll be so open and they'll come out and play, that will leave a lot of spaces for Arsenal to now exploit, whether it's midfield, or for our fullbacks to now bump forward.
So your prediction?
My prediction is, I'd probably say 3-0 Arsenal.
You feel Burnley is not going to score?
Yeah, I feel we should be able to get a clean sheet. But if we don't keep a clean sheet, then it might just be through a mistake that any of our defenders just giving the ball away cheaply,
cheaply on the mat.
Because they decided to take their foot off the gas.
Yeah, okay, and that would be good. And on Wednesday we go there to FC Porto to get. We are going to Portugal to face FC Porto in the Champions League. I think it's back. What's your take on that one?
With regards to that, I think Porto in their league, they've not been doing too badly. They've kind of been doing similar to us in our league. I expect us to get the win, but I don't know if it's going to be a big win. I think it's probably going to be a narrow win. But I do know...
Don't forget Lisbon the other day. We lost. We clashed out of the Europa League at Portugal. Sporting Lisbon, to be precise, last season.
Yeah, we did. And I feel last season it was more to do with the fact that we didn't take the Europa seriously, and we underestimated Sporting Lisbon. I feel with Porto, as long as we take them seriously and we play our best starting 11, we should be able to get a result. I think it'll be a very close game. It might be a 2-1 victory. That's what I expect. Because I do know Porto have a decent striker who plays for them, who we've been linked with. Evan Nilsson.
Yes. But generally now, let me ask you, because I think we're 27 minutes, I want to round it up now. Generally now, let me now ask you this question. Can we win this league? Can we overtake Liverpool, Manchester City, and win this league? Is it better the way we, can we actually win this league? Let me just put it straight that way. Does Big Rook, do you believe we can win the league?
Do I believe we can win the league? That's a good question. I don't even know if I can confidently say that we can win the league, only because of the fact that yes, we might be scoring goals now, but when it comes to now crunch time, with either 3 or 5 games to go, if we're against teams that will be fighting for top four, fighting for Europe or fighting for relegation, are we going to be able to score enough goals to seal the game? Because I know, yes, we might be good defensively, but we need to be able to try and find a way to score, especially when teams will do the low block, because sometimes in those type of games where other teams are fighting for something, we might have games where decisions go against us, and maybe when we're not scoring, and games for example, we should be scoring or winning, we might end up drawing them or losing them 1-0. And that could be the difference between us winning the league and us not winning the league, because I feel like our record against the teams we're competing for the league is good. I just feel it's gonna be like teams like that are fighting for like them who have like the low blocks, so like the smaller teams. But when I look at our squad, I feel we should, if we get to April and we're in like let's say semi-finals, we're in the quarterfinals or semis, and we're like maybe two or 3 points behind the team that is second, then maybe I feel we should just put some of our eggs into the Champions League and say, you know what, let's just focus more on the Champions League and sustaining our spots in the top three. Because
Rookie, what you just said now, let me ask you a question. Mikel Arteta winning the Champions League. What's your opinion? What, as in, how would you feel for Mikel Arteta winning the Champions League?
if he did that, I'd feel happy, but I don't expect us to win the champion. I expect us to try and get to the semis max, quarters minimum.
All right, Big Rook, thank you so much for joining me today. Thank you so much. And we're looking forward to seeing you again anytime soon. Don't
Yeah.
forget, Big Rook, he has his channels. Don't forget his channel link is on, it will be in the description of this video. And also, don't forget, he's in the, like he said, he has his own channel and he's in the UK. You might want to contact him. He also does some other things. You can actually reach him on his channel. And things, yeah, don't forget to like, subscribe, and share the video. Thank you so
Definitely.
much, Bigu, for seeing you.
Thanks for
I
having me
guess we'll be
here.
meeting we, I guess we'll be hooking up late sometimes later very soon.
Yeah, for sure.
All right, take care, bro. Have a nice day.
Same to you. Take care. Bye.
Bye.